take a closer look now at what's at stake in the election. We have with us Attorney Christian Monsod. He's one of the framers of the 1987 Constitution and a former Paul Body Commissioner. Good afternoon, Attorney Christian, and welcome to ANC's coverage of Halalan 22.
Good afternoon, sir.
All right. Now, you've worn many hats at the Commission on Elections, one of which, of course, was in the 80s when you headed the poll body. And now you're witnessing a different kind of elections, far different from what you have experienced and mounted yourself back then. And we also have a bigger number of voters. The population has grown and we've gone automated. Now, that automated election has exhibited some glitches today. What are your thoughts on what just happened, given the glitches of the VCMs and some flaws in the processes that a lot of voters have experienced today?
Well, you know, if you look at history, mm-hmm. There were a lot of reservations about automation, and especially on an automated count at the precinct level. But since 2010, people have accepted the results of the elections despite its imperfections, and there has been a peaceful transfer of power. I think that's the issue in this election, in the context of the change framework, the communication framework, is we have a peaceful transfer of power. That's why I was listening very closely to the PNP and the armed forces on how many incidents are happening in these elections. Because that's, to me, that's what we have to really be concerned about, is a peaceful transfer of power.
Right, and authorities are saying it has been relatively peaceful, although we know for a fact that the precincts have not closed. Counting will soon begin this evening and all through the night. Many things can still happen. Do you share that view that this has been a relatively peaceful election?
I'm sorry, can you speak louder?
Yes, the Philippine National Police, you said a while ago you were listening to the press conference of the Commission on Elections. We heard the AFP and the PNP already calling it a relatively peaceful election. Do you share that view?
No, I don't share that view. It's too early. And you know they have a very fixed framework for determining what happened, what violence the elections, and as he said, they include January up to I think right after elections. Mm-hmm. It's very funny because you know in the case of the Maguindanao massacre of November 2009, which is very clearly directed towards the 2010 elections, the victims, the incident is not included in the PNP record of violence of previous elections. And I hope that they will be their definitions of when and what kind of incidents happen in these elections will not be artificially downgraded or reduced by definitions and boundaries. But I think that the PNP and the AFP, one of the problems is what if there is failure of election? Mm-hmm. Actually, the COMELEC can call special elections in those areas, say next week. They don't have to postpone it or declare a failure of election.
Yes. The Commission on Elections has, in fact, communicated that. That's a possibility that failure of election can be declared on the precinct level only and does not cover the entire town. And that's very possible given all of the reports suspected election fraud that's been happening.
It's just a question about failure of election was tried once. I think it was in 2004. During Arroyo's time, and the military were asked if Arroyo can be allowed to stay on if there is a failure of election. Of course, there was none, but the military was asked by the political leaders if that's possible. And I hope that they're not thinking of that now.
Attorney Mansod, Denise Dinsai here. We just want to talk about the PCU report on the spending of COMELEC on these elections. I know they spent an additional $1.5 billion to COVID-proof these elections, as it is the first time that we are holding, you know, our elections in the middle of a pandemic. But there are reports that, of course, the COMELEC is operating on a bloated budget. You know, usually, what are the normal costs to hold an election?
There is something abnormal today. So automatically, you have to really increase the budget of the COMELEC. The people are getting higher pay. There are more people included within the frontliners of the COMELEC. They have to provide supplies and personnel to allow for the pandemic situation and so on. And also, this COMELEC inherited a very bad decision before to buy those machines, those equipment. It was a very bad decision at the time, and I suspect that a lot of money passed because the decision to purchase the equipment is one of the problems being faced by the COMELEC today. And it's not the COMELEC's fault today that they have to live with that kind with equipment that are what, how many years old? So that's a situation, and I can see why the budget was increased. And there are two people who have reviewed that. NAMPREL has reviewed it. Former Commissioner Guia, who was recently retired from the COMELEC, also reviewed it. And both of them said that it is correct, the increase in the budget.
Now, Attorney Mansod, you just mentioned that the COMELEC before really made a bad decision with, of course, the previous technology used. Moving forward, you know, we're encountering even more problems. These elections, what are the next steps that should be taken to prevent this from happening in the next one?
You mean in the future?
Yes.
We're talking about future. Well, I think we should seriously review the automation of the voting and counting at the precinct. It may take a little longer. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we need to do that, because before the wholesale cheating occurred at the canvassing level, not at the precinct level, and that was the original concept of automation, which started during my time. When you look at future elections, you have to think of two things: the quality of the process and the quality of the vote. If we're talking about the quality of the vote, vote buying has increased, and the COMELEC did not advocate for an anti-dynasty law, because part of our problem are entrenched political dynasties, mm-hmm. and the Congress has been sleeping on that for, 35 years. Number two, the COMELEC should have amended the party list law, because they're just too many, like amoeba-like multiplication, and now how many there are? There are about 170. There should be coalitions of farmers, urban poor, indigenous peoples, professionals, and so on. We don't have to have 170. And the party list law should be amended to include an anti-dynasty law and to remove the maximum of 3 representatives for coalitions. Because it becomes anomalous that a coalition or a party would have had 5 or 6 or 7 representatives, and their vote is transferred to another party or coalition that has nothing to do with that advocacy, and that's not fair. Mm-hmm. Party list is a proportional representation system. And that maximum of 3 breeds all kinds of multiplication of entries in order to have more representation and so on. Imagine 170 party lists participating.
Yes.
Also, there should be something done about the inequity of radio time and TV time that favor the rich. during our time, the COMELEC could allocate radio and TV time to levelize the playing field. And I think that should be rethought. Also, the automated law should be amended because we're still, we're still a hybrid. For example, protests are still decided on manual counting of the ballots, and it's supposed to be an automated system. There are many amendments that that should be made in the election laws. And I'm sorry that the past COMELEC have been sleeping on the job.
All right. Attorney Munson.
By the way, the other one is warlordism. Mm-hmm. Warlordism, I was just looking at the gun ban. And they said they issued permits for officials. Why is that? During my time, even the COMELEC didn't have bodyguards, right? Why do you give them bodyguards and allow them arms? And we have understated the imports of arms in the Philippines by about 65%. Our record of imports is only 35% of the record of exports into the Philippines. Warlordism and private armies is a big problem in our country.
Yes, Attorney Monsod, we would have had an opportunity to implement reforms, particularly on political dynasties. As you have mentioned, even the Constitution had tackled this after the Revolution.
I've heard that before.
Yes, why was it left to the House of Representatives to create an enabling law to put that in place,
to define political dynasty? I'll tell you why. We made two mistakes in the Constitutional Commission. We overestimated the spirit of EDSA, and we underestimated the greed of politicians. The idea of leaving it to Congress is this: that if our democracy matures, maybe you don't need a prohibition of 4 degrees. Maybe you need only 2 degrees. And as we improve our democracy, we may not need an anti-dynasty law at all. Mm-hmm. So why should the definition of political dynasty be in the Constitution? Then you need a constitutional amendment. Congress should be able to adapt to the changing times and the improvement of the quality of our democracy. But that's not what happened. And you know, we have to correct that. And I hope that the future administrations will be able to do that. But that was the reason why we decided not to define political dynasties in the Constitution itself.
Now, Attorney Monsod, you were just tackling about, you know, the role of the Constitution, of course, also of the government and administration in being able to implement a better watertight, a very tight-proof, you know, Constitution when it comes to political dynasties. But what about, you know, the people? They have quite a love-hate relationship with it. For some, it's quite selective. For some, they're okay with it. For some, they're not. You know, why do you think Filipinos have this kind of mindset towards dynasties?
Well, I'll tell you, patronage pass politics on. And you know, EDSA was not only about the restoration of democracy. It was the promise of a new social order. And every administration after EDSA failed in that promise, to fulfill that promise. And thus, so there's a hidden anger in the minds of our poor against elitist leadership controlling wealth and power in our country. And that has to change. Of course, we need a transformational leader, but we also need a transformational people. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you look at political leadership, you have to look at it like a dyad, you know, D-Y-A-D, and like a marriage is a dyad.
Yeah.
Right? You cannot examine the leadership and not examine the followers. And that's what we need for a full transformation of our society. We need both a transformational leader and a transformational people. I don't see us being transformational, maybe transactional, but we, for the people, look at what we did, right? We brought down a dictatorship in Marcos, then we bury him as a hero. Then Estrada was convicted of corruption. Then he was forgiven and restored all his civil and political rights. And then elected twice as mayor of Manila. So yes, you have to examine the followers of the leader and the leader itself. Otherwise, you're not be able to understand why we're behaving themselves. We are an enigma as a people. Yeah. As Duterte is an enigma as a leader, right? So to me, if we succeed in this election to really elect a transformational leader, it's only the first step towards a new social order. First step. Yeah. The next step is December 2022 in the barangay elections. We must encourage the church, business, and civil society to put the poor leaders to control the barangays.
Attorney
That's
Monson.
The first, right? And we go on, municipal, provincial, and so on, Attorney until Monson. We have a new generation of leaders who come from the poor.
Attorney.
That's when we have social change.